And thanks for joining Science at Sugarlands. This is brought to you by Discover Life in America. We are a nonprofit partner of Great Smoky Mountains National Park that works to catalog every single animal, plant, and other species living in the Smokies. And we also do lots of biodiversity education projects, as well as research with the park and more. You can find out more about us at dlia.org. So today we are excited to welcome Jeff Hunter of the National Parks Conservation Association. And correct, Jeff, you are not sharing yet. And Jeff is going to talk about Safe Passage, which is this, which he will explain more about. I will let him do that. But this is a program, Science at Sugarlands is a program that we have every month until October. And so if you want to tune in next month on July 15th, Adelia Dorfield of Great Smoky Mountains National Park will be talking about the African American experience, which is also going to be really awesome. So, and all of our talks are recorded and put on our YouTube channel, Discover Life in America. So with that, Jeff, take it away.
Thank you, Will. Really appreciate the opportunity to give a presentation for your organization, both on a personal level and for NPCA, biodiversity protection is a top priority. And that's what you guys do. You're in the business of biodiversity, chronicling it. You can't protect what you don't know exists, right? So big shout out to you all. And for those of you tuning in, thank you. You could be other places today and you chose to be here, and I'm grateful for that. So my name is Jeff Hunter. I'm a program manager with National Parks Conservation Association, as Will said. I'm coming to you today from my home office in Burnsville, North Carolina. This is in the mountains, not far from Mount Mitchell. Mount Mitchell is about 15 miles that way. So I'm right here at the base of the Black Mountains. And I'm going to be talking to you today about a collaborative project that we call Safe Passage, the I-40 Pigeon River Gorge Wildlife Crossing Project. And so let's jump into it. Let me share my screen, get this PowerPoint going. Looking good with the presentation? You can see that? Okay, thumbs up. Great. Yeah, so right out of the box, let's make this clear. This, as I said, is a collaborative project. If any one organization tells you that they alone resolved an intractable problem like we're dealing with here on a large landscape that's multi-jurisdictional, it really doesn't pass the straight face test. We couldn't do this, what I'm about to talk to you about, without federal, state, tribal, and non-governmental organizations coming together, working in common cause to try to address wildlife vehicle collisions on a 28-mile stretch of I-40. So you see, with two states, we have two departments of transportation. We have two life agencies. Of course, we have the National Park Service. We have the U.S. Forest Service, both in North Carolina, the Pisgah National Forest, and in Tennessee, the Cherokee National Forest. The Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians has been involved for quite some time, Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, Wildlands Network, Defenders of Wildlife, others. Even the Federal Highways Administration has been involved, and I'll talk about that a little bit as we move along. So I want to give this is a science project where the project I'm talking to you about is data-driven, evidence-based, and these are our two principal co-researchers. This is Steve Goodman on the left. He works with me at National Parks Conservation Association, and Dr. Liz Hillard on the right works for Wildlands Network. And together they designed a study which involved deploying wildlife cameras over a 28-mile stretch over somewhere between 115 and 120, depending on the day, GPS collaring 13 elk and a whole lot more. So let's dive right into it. The mission of this collaborative effort is to improve wildlife's ability to safely cross I-40 in the Pigeon River Gorge. And this should improve public safety for the motorists. This is what the highway looks like from the air. I'm sure many, if not all of you, have driven this corridor before. It's a narrow, winding road through the mountains, it's hard to gain an understanding for the scale of the public lands that surround this. But when you get up into a light plane, like we did here with our partners at South Wings, you start to see the extent of the public lands. And this is really, really prime wildlife habitat on both sides of the highway. And that's why we see so many animals get hit and killed, right? This highway was built in 1968, wasn't really designed with wildlife in mind. And in fact, going back that far, the black bear population was a fraction of what it is today in 1968. Elk were not on this landscape. They've been extirpated for nearly 200 years. They were reintroduced 2001, 2002, and now they have spread to both sides of this highway. So a lot going on. Here's another view. This is a really interesting view here, and I want to point out this location right here. If you have driven from Knoxville to Asheville, you go through two tunnels. When you come back from Asheville to Knoxville, you only go through one. Here is a place we call the double tunnel. And this is the location where both the east and westbound lanes of I-40 are tunneled through the mountain, which has left in place a land bridge right here. Very much like a wildlife overpass, right? And that was area number one. We really wanted to understand that. I set boots on the ground up there in September 2016. Saw all kinds of evidence of black bear. No signs of humans, no trash, no footprints, none of that. So it was an area we honed in on. We set cameras on top of that land bridge in 2017. So why here? Why would we expend valuable resources and time studying this issue in the Pigeon River Gorge? Well, for my organization, the nexus with the national park is key, right? So Great Smoky Mountains National Park at approximately 523,000 acres is the most visited national park in the entire system, 14.1 million visitors last year. And it's surrounded by a matrix of public lands, as I mentioned, the Pisgah National Forest, the Cherokee National Forest, the Nantahala National Forest to the south. This is, these lands are enjoyed by the American public. They're filled with wildlife. This area is within a day's drive of half of the population of the United States, right? So there's a couple of few reasons. Another reason is, most of this kind of work we're talking about, mitigating wildlife vehicle collisions, has taken place in the Western United States. But that doesn't mean the Eastern United States doesn't have issues and shouldn't be a priority. So although a lot of this type of work has been done in Florida for the Florida panther down by the Everglades, where they built underpasses and have fencing for wildlife, we don't see that too much in North Carolina and Tennessee yet. So there are a lot of reasons to do this, whether it's public safety or to minimize impacts to wildlife, but this is also very much a climate project. This is a map put together by the Nature Conservancy called Migrations in Motion, and it shows the future projected movements of plants and animals. And you can see where our study area is right here. It is, the epicenter of these movements. The Appalachian Mountains are going to be key. Wildlife is responding to climate by, generally speaking, moving towards the poles. It needs to go north. That means it needs to get across I-40, I-26, I-77, all these east-west roads that cross the Appalachians. In order to do that, we're going to have to reconnect these landscapes with underpasses, overpasses, and that's what we're talking about here today. I'm going to show you a quick video. It's 17 seconds, and it probably tells you more about this project than I can in 40 minutes. It was shot on an August afternoon, I believe, in 2018 by Susan Detweiler. Roll it. So if you've driven this corridor, you don't want to be at a total standstill on this road. There's a lot of truck traffic. It clearly shows the peril to both wildlife and to the motorists. And it doesn't always end the way we just saw, right? This bear family made it across the road. But in 3 years of research, I believe we had 103 dead bears that we found on the side of I-40. And that That number is probably low by a factor of about 2.8, because not everything that gets hit dies in the road, right? Sometimes it makes it over the guardrail or over the concrete barrier you're seeing here. People pick up the carcasses before they can be counted. So that's just a fraction of what's going on here. Let's dive into this landscape a little bit deeper. So here is the northwestern part of the park in blue. This is the Appalachian National Scenic Trail, another unit of the National Park Service. Again, so there's a nexus of interest for my organization. We have in green here, the Pisgah National Forest. This stippled area is the Harmon Den Bear Sanctuary. The Harmon Den exit, which we'll talk about a bit, is right here. And this is the Cherokee National Forest. So there's private lands, public lands. It's a matrix. There's also some lands that have been conserved by our partners at the Southern Appalachian Highlands Conservancy, a super important partner of ours. They acquired this 147-acre Stevens Creek tract, which is adjacent to the park on White Oak Mountain near the Fines Creek community. And then they also acquired 187 acres with about a mile of frontage on I-40. This is directly across the highway from the North Carolina Welcome Center, around approximately mile marker 10 or 11. And it just so happens that this Wilkins Creek parcel is adjacent to our highest black bear mortality issues in the entire gorge. So it's a really opportune acquisition, and we're grateful for our land trust partners for doing that. This is the big, hairy, audacious goal. This is a wildlife overpass up in Banff National Park. It's a bridge over a highway, but it's designed specifically for wildlife, so it's naturally vegetated. Notice there's fencing. Fencing is key whenever you do this kind of work. This is the underneath approach. This is a wildlife underpass. See a couple of elk there, again, Banff National Park. You've got fencing to funnel wildlife to this location. And this is what we'd like to see eventually in the gorge. It's going to take some time, but this is what we're shooting for. More underpasses, more overpasses, all based on a research approach. So I mentioned the research that Liz and Steve led. There are four objectives to assess wildlife road mortality. That involved weekly driving surveys looking for dead animals. We did not use a citizen science approach like Discover Life in America does, simply because the highway is too dangerous to have people record this information. So we relied on staff for that. Every once in a while, someone from the park or the Forest Service or someone would report an animal dead on the road, and that was helpful, certainly. And then research objective two was to assess wildlife activity within the highway right of way. To do that, we used wildlife cameras. And then objective three is to assess wildlife's use of existing structures. These are places where wildlife can go under, whether it's interchanges, box culverts, concrete box culverts, things like that. And then the fourth objective is to collar some elk and see where they go with relation to the highway. So regarding objective number one, we see far too much mortality on the side of the road. Our focal species are elk, white-tailed deer, and bear for a couple of reasons. Number one, they're fairly easy to monitor, but you can also quantify the amount of damage to a vehicle if you strike one of these large mammals. So those are the species we were tabulating. Smaller mammals really don't have much of a shot to cross this road because of the concrete barrier. And Steve Goodman, my colleague, aggregated about 20 years of historical data prior to 2018. This data was scattered across the two departments of transportation in Tennessee and North Carolina. There were police reports from Highway Patrol that we pulled together. Also, the Wildlife Resource Commission in North Carolina and TWRA in Tennessee had some information. Pulled it all together, started doing surveys, and lo and behold, the amount of mortality we saw in our 3 years of driving surveys was six times the historical number, which tells you right out of the box that the mortality was undercounted for years. So people get hung up on the numbers sometimes. What are the numbers? You know, the numbers tell a story, right? They tell us where the hotspots are. When you start to stack mortalities in the same location, you say, ah, here's where we clearly have a problem. This is the Wilkins Creek tract area right here, the hottest hotspot that we have adjacent to Waterville Lake. So that's very telling and very helpful information. So regarding Objective number two, we utilize Reconyx cameras. They were provided by a variety of agencies. The North Carolina Wildlife Resource Commission loaned us 69. The Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation provided funding to purchase 30. And we had 40 that were donated by private donors, all the same model of camera, Reconyx Hyperfire. The logos you see here are folks that were involved on one level or another, either providing right-of-way permits to deploy these cameras, doing things of that nature. It really is very much a collaborative effort at every moment in this project. So Liz and Steve, as I mentioned, designed this study. The purpose of this slide more than anything is to show you the methodology and how we deployed these cameras. So there's the highway, and here's a camera facing away from the roadway. So anything that comes down, a mammal, movement or heat will trigger that, and we get to see what's approaching the roadway. And we were trying to see, is there a correlation between animal activity in the right-of-way and mortality or not? So our data collection involved going out and retrieving the SD cards in these cameras periodically, sometimes once a month, sometimes with our remoter cameras, a little bit longer interval. But we had more than 25,000 unique events where an animal triggered our camera. We had more than 2,000 incidents with bear. You can see 4,000 with white-tailed deer, 65 with almost 1,000 bobcat. That doesn't mean 1,000 individuals, right? That means 1,000 interactions where a bobcat tripped our camera. Some of those are the same critters because the cameras are set up in their home range, right? But, you know, Discover Life in America is not just interested in these big charismatic megafauna, right? They're interested in everything, whether it's fungi or all sorts of things. Well, we weren't camera trapping fungi, but we were seeing things like long-tailed weasels, which is a species of special concern in North Carolina. Spotted skunks, and also armadillos, which are moving in from Tennessee and colonizing habitat in Western North Carolina. Our cameras were set from exit 443 in Tennessee, where the Foothills Parkway enters the highway, all the way to the state line here. That's 8 miles, and then 20 miles from the state line to Maggie Valley, exit 20. So that's 28 miles of total study area, a lot of area to cover. And here are some photographs of some of the critters that we've seen. Top right is an American mink. Bottom right is a spotted skunk. They're pretty cool. If you've not heard of them, they're about the size of a gray squirrel. They stand on their front legs to spray when they feel intimidated. And they also are arboreal. They can climb trees. In the upper left-hand corner is a long-tailed weasel. I'll show you another photo of those in a little bit. And then the common red fox in the lower left-hand corner. We also photographed less often its kin, the gray fox. Gray foxes also, like spotted skunks, can climb trees. Who knew? So here is here's a photo from some new research we've just started conducting on Interstate 26 in Tennessee and North Carolina. And this down here is a long-tailed weasel under a highway bridge, carrying a large rat. So he's, this is one happy weasel right here. Look at the tail is up, eyes are wide open, ears are erect, and that is a big rat right here in the mouth of a little critter. Where was that photo taken? Well, here we are up again in a South Wings flight, and that long-tailed weasel was under this bridge, on this side of the bridge above the stream. Very cool. We've now deployed about 50 cameras along I-26, and we're continuing to build out that research as I speak. So regarding that objective two, this is an interesting pair right here, this cow elk and her calf. This cow would sometimes be seen near Hartford on one side of the highway, and then the next day on the other side of the highway. And rafting guides reached out to me and told me, you know, we don't know how she's crossing. So she became a candidate for a GPS collar, and in fact was eventually collared, and we found out that she was crossing the highway at one place under the highway and another place right across the roadway, jumping across the concrete barrier and doing that in the middle of the night. That's why she's still with us. These are just some photos of from our cameras white-tailed deer. Check out this black bear reacting to an 18-wheeler going by. Studies have shown that bears can detect the peril that these rows pose for them. Their heart rate increases, their respiratory rate increases. We often see them panting as they approach the road. Their sense of smell is about 7 times greater than a bloodhound. So, you know, for me, if I'm near the highway for any extent of time, the fumes are just, it gives me a headache, you know. So can you imagine a bear with senses far more acute than you and I? Here's another photo of a bear, again, surveying the highway, looking for opportunities to cross. We see this quite a bit. Another bear, same location, checking out the highway. We see this with coyotes also and other mammals sometimes looking down. In terms of research objective number 3, to assess wildlife use of existing structures. When I say structures, I'm talking about metal culverts like these at Groundhog Creek, creek culverts with open bottoms, bridge underpasses, box culverts made of concrete, river bridges like this Bluffton Bridge in Tennessee, and then the double tunnel, which I talked to you about earlier. By the way, right here on the cliffs above the double tunnel, we do sometimes have peregrine falcons nesting. And when we're up here checking cameras from time to time, we would see and hear the peregrine falcons, which are an endangered species. So here's a series of photos showing wildlife using our existing structures. This bear took about 10 minutes and 3 attempts before it finally went through and out the other side. So we have cameras on either side of the bridge. At this location, we had cameras stolen multiple times. We lost 20 cameras in 2 years to either theft or vandalism, and that's the price of doing business. You know, people are driving by, they see the cameras, and whatever the motivation, they would steal them. The Wildlife Resource Commission in North Carolina replaced every single camera that was stolen or vandalized. So much gratitude for that. Now, unlike that black bear you just saw, this elk, no hesitation whatsoever, in one side, out the other. This young bull, we call a traveler. It was born in the park. It left the park, went down to South Carolina, returned to the park, went over to Tennessee, came back to North Carolina, crossed through this box culvert, went back to Tennessee, where it was legally harvested by a deer hunter in Tennessee, where they do not have an elk hunt. So, but this animal before it passed certainly taught us a lot about habitat selection and what sort of habitat it moves through. This is a little bit harder to see, but this is a bobcat. Again, no hesitation in and out. Bobcats are pretty stealthy. They do prefer things like wildlife underpasses, and many of the structures that we're talking about potentially building are species specific. Right? Elk like big open structures, whether it's a large open underpass or a large bridge span, a wildlife overpass. A bear will use culverts, but they'll also use overpasses. And we're hoping if we can improve permeability, the ability to move across the highway for these critters, that the little things will benefit also, maybe even, you know, reptiles and amphibians. Depends upon where they get built, of course. Here's our cow and calf elk. I told you earlier that the collar data, and you can see she's wearing a GPS collar here, told us where she's crossing. Well, guess where she crossed back to the park from the other side? It's at Waterville on the state line. This is the Appalachian Trail. This is where hikers cross under I-40, and elk were doing the same thing. So very smart animal. As I mentioned, they did cross the pavement multiple times, and it's miraculous they're still with us. Here's our cameras documenting a culvert that we didn't see any of our target species go through. But with a metal culvert like this, a hooved animal like this deer, wouldn't stand a chance. It'd be like ice walking on that slick metal. So they might check it out, but we didn't see anything other than things like raccoons and mink and otters move through this structure. Raccoons will move through just about anything. Larger mammals are more selective. Here's another small culvert, and here's a young bear checking it out. We didn't see any of our target species cross here, even though in this instance, you can see light on the other side of the tunnel, which is sort of best practice for an underpass like this. Animals will often select a structure like this if they can see the light on the other side. But nothing moved through here. These structures are like highway opened in 1968. So let's do a little math, about 54 years old. So in many cases they're rusting, they need to be replaced. And we're hoping our recommendation here is to increase the size of the culvert when they replace it, make it bigger so things can pass through. Some of our recommendations also in some of the structures are to build some shelving to allow things like bobcats and other critters that don't like to get their feet wet to move through. These structures were not designed to pass wildlife. They were designed to move water under the highway. And that water sometimes acts as a barrier to movement. We do have some culverts that bear and coyote and other critters will go through. We saw quite a few bear cross through these metal culverts at Groundhog Creek in the Pisgah National Forest. This is between Harmondden and the Double Tunnel. Check this out. So a lot of people ask, well, you know, how do they learn how to use these structures? The adults will often teach their young to use the structure, and then it just becomes one more corridor for them to use. Fencing, of course, is critical. And check this video out. It's looping here, but this is November 17, 2019 at 3:30 in the morning. There's the adult cat. There's the kitten underneath. The kitten could not figure out how to negotiate this culvert, right? 4 days later, this is where the learning comes in. Same pair. There's mama flashing the tail. Boop. Right through. So they can learn. It's really pretty fascinating. Let's watch that tail signaling behavior again, because it's pretty neat. She gets up, checks around, flashes the tail. Coast is clear. Come on through. This is the concrete box culvert where we saw some animals moving through. This is adjacent to the Wilkins Creek tract I mentioned earlier that was acquired by the Southern Appalachian Highlands Conservancy. And here's a large male bear diverting and crossing the highway at grade. That's how they get killed. It doesn't want to use this structure, goes up top. And we find dead bears here far too often. So this is an area we're looking at fencing to improve the use of this structure. And if that doesn't work, potentially a wildlife overpass somewhere near here. Regarding fencing, this is right-of-way fencing. It's not wildlife fencing, but if you have wildlife fencing, you have to bury it. And this bear is telling us why. It's a young bear and right under the fence. Yep. So bury that fence. Wildlife fencing is generally 8 to 10 feet high and buried. I'm going to show you a couple other species that are not target species, but since we're talking about biodiversity, there's a really neat series with river otters. We do see them quite a bit. They inhabit the Pigeon River and they move around using these culverts. This is a little bit hard to see here, but here's a Buteo. Looks like a red-tailed hawk, and it's got a gray squirrel in its talons. So that was a pretty interesting find. There's a whole series of photos from this encounter. We have a lot of photos of birds, including owls. Really just amazing when you start looking at the images that we have. This is up on top of the Double Tunnel, going all the way back to 2018, before our research technically started. We were trying to get an understanding of what was going on here. This is a melanistic coyote, a little mangy. You can see his hair is falling out in his tail. Look at it though, it's looking at the camera. It can hear the camera, it knows that's not part of the natural environment. Very, very wary, but quite a pretty animal. And here's a large male bear behind the North Carolina Welcome Center in the snow. Just a really pretty picture. So let's talk a little bit about Dr. Hillard's elk project. Now, she was reliant upon the North Carolina Wildlife Resource Commission and the National Park Service wildlife technicians to dart these animals so that they can be fitted with a collar. And so that's what you see here. It's working as a team. They sedated the animal, covered the eyes to keep them calm, fitted them with a collar, and then we could start to get data like this. This is our cow and calf right here. You can see she's crossing the highway just near the state line. One of the things that you can do with the GPS technology and software ArcGIS is you can create something that we call, it's like an invisible fence here. And so the animal's moving here, sends a signal about every 2 hours, excuse me. But if it comes inside this electronic fence into this area, it'll send a ping out every 20 minutes, excuse me. So you get that finer scale data so we can understand where these animals are moving with relation to the highway. Really important. And so once you start getting this data coming in, you can start to see these movements. This is where that young bull elk was killed on I-40, actually was hit, made it down to the river where it had to be euthanized by a Park Service biologist. Another animal with a collar was hit down here by Murphy, North Carolina. Another traveler left the park, went through Bryson City, moved into the Nantahala National Forest, came all the way down past Andrews, and was hit on Highway 64 near Murphy and totaled a large suburban. The Eastern Band of Cherokee Indians is very interested in this area here. This is US 19 between Maggie Valley and Cherokee. And the tribe is disproportionately impacted by wildlife vehicle collisions involving elk. This is one hot spot here, a place called Soco Gap where the Blue Ridge Parkway crosses US 19. We haven't deployed cameras here yet, but Liz's collar data is very instrumental. There's early talk about widening Highway 19 to 3 or 4 lanes. And so when they do that, this data can help them actually look at where wildlife could potentially cross the road so they can mitigate. This right here is the Harmon Den interchange, exit 7 in North Carolina. Some of you may be aware that this bridge here was replaced and the highway was reopened just the week before Memorial Day. We were 4 months into our 2-year research project when the DOT announced they were going to replace 5 bridges in our project area, including Harmon Den. Well, this is a key one here because this is where elk first crossed from the park side of the highway to the other side of the highway. Now we have a small herd growing on the opposite side of the highway from where the park is. So we know wildlife's moving here. We're seeing more wildlife in the right of way here than just about any place else. So we asked the DOT to make sure they incorporated wildlife enhancements into this project, but they said, guess what? We can't do it because the scope of the project was bridge replacement only. It was not a wildlife project and they're constrained by the state legislature about what they can do. Myself and a number of partners got together. We discussed the idea of starting a fund to bring private dollars to the table. We agreed to do that. We approached the DOT, said, will you work with us if we raise the money? They said they would. And we've since raised about $115,000 through the Smokies Safe Passage Fund. And now the DOT has opened this bridge. It's got one fewer expansion joint, so it's quieter, which will help move animals. They're building a bench on either side of Cold Spring Creek. They're putting up wildlife fencing. They're putting cattle guards here on the on and off ramp so elk won't walk up here. Jump outs here, so in case an animal does get inside the highway, it has a way to get out. So very, very encouraging. It's the first of what we hope to be many projects in the gorge. Back in March 29th, at a meeting of the stakeholders, we released our research recommendations and finding. We'll be releasing them publicly in a couple of months. And it offers 21 recommendations for mitigation, including 3 wildlife overpasses, a number of underpasses, fencing, and some smaller things like as you replace this bridge at this location, don't mess it up, right? Because it's working for wildlife. So sometimes our recommendation is do no harm. Right now we're chasing resources so that the 2 DOTs can conduct feasibility studies to see if our recommendations are plausible, right? We're wildlife biologists, not highway engineers. So the geology in the gorge can be unstable in places. We wanna make sure that what we're recommending is actually possible. So there's a lot going on. We have some new cameras. These phone home, they have data plans and we're deploying them. Pretty neat. It's an efficiency thing for us because we don't actually have to go out and pull the SD card. If one of these cameras is stolen, we'll actually get photographs of the people who stole them because they're right up in the cloud immediately. So it's a nice addition for us. And we're deploying them on I-26. Up here, near Wolf Laurel exit 3 on I-26 in Tennessee. That's a black bear, that little dot all the way up here, believe it or not. And this is not an uncommon sight on I-26. About 20 minutes later, that large male walked right past one of those cameras that phoned home. So this was us just on June 1st, not long ago, right? What's today, the 17th? So 17 days ago, 16 days ago. So here is our branding for Safe Passage, the I-40 Pigeon River Gorge Wildlife Crossing Project. We worked with a marketing firm, Ellie Wells in Asheville, and her team designed this logo so that people can recognize it when they see it. We also did a lot of outreach that resulted in amazing media coverage throughout not only Tennessee and North Carolina, but nationally. You know, whether they're articles in a print edition, newspaper, the newsletter of one of our stakeholders like the North Carolina Wildlife Federation. We're also working closely with the Tennessee Wildlife Federation. Podcast, I have a podcast interview with a National Parks Traveler that really gets down in the weeds. And a big shout out to Frances Feigert at Great Smoky Mountains Association. She's done a lot of our writing and a lot of the work with the media. And I'm singling her out, right? But, you know, there's Ben Prater with Defenders of Wildlife and Manley Fuller and Tim Geswicki with the North Carolina Wildlife Federation, Stephen Dobie with the Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, Hugh Irwin with the Wilderness Society. You know, I could go on. There's lots of folks here. And of course, Wildlands Network is super key. Here's some of our marketing images, home, dinner, family time, all on the other side, right? It says it all. And so if you're interested in learning more, you can go on our website at smokiesafepassage.org. We have Facebook and Instagram. You can follow us there. You can get involved by making a donation or taking a pledge to you know, drive the speed limit in black bear country, watch out for wildlife, things like that. It's a great way to stay connected with what it is that we're trying to do. And we've raised $115,000, a little more than that so far. Here's some really, really good news. When we developed the Safe Passage Fund, there were no federal dollars for this sort of work. But last year, Congress passed the bipartisan infrastructure bill, which includes $350 million by vehicle collisions over 5 years. We're working with the DOTs right now to make sure that they can be competitive for these grants when they're announced. And it's exciting, right? We've got change that's taken place within the culture of our departments of transportation. They were initially in North Carolina, certainly a little reticent to engage with us early in 2017. And now we have support for this project at the highest levels of government in North Carolina, as you'll see in just a minute. I would be remiss if I didn't give a big shout out to Frances Feigert and Emma Dufour, the writer and illustrator, respectively, of A Search for Safe Passage, a children's book focused at kids aged 7 to 13, but also appropriate for adults, right? It's kind of a parable which tells the tale of how wildlife is searching to get safely across I-40. It's a fictional account project. Francis Taylor Barnhill is going to write a book.
Yeah, so we did hear the part talking about the Safe Passage book. And do you want to continue sharing, or was sure. That the end?
Yeah, let me share my screen. Sorry about that, folks. I got a note, my internet was unstable, and next thing you know, ba-boom. Okay, can you see that okay?
Yep.
Great. So I talked about Safe Passage, got that. Here is a photograph from June the 2nd. This is Emma Dufour with SMA, the illustrator for A Search for Safe Passage. These students from Fernleaf Community Charter School in Fletcher, North Carolina, along with about 40 other classmates, read the book and wrote letters to Governor Roy Cooper, who is right here, North Carolina's governor, all on board. The Republican chairman of the North Carolina Department of Transportation, the board, totally on board. We've really made some tremendous progress. So exciting things
are in store in the coming months. We really have changed the culture of these organizations. And that's the biggest story out of this, because we're going to start to see the agencies integrating wildlife into projects statewide in Tennessee and North Carolina as we move forward. So with that, I'd like to show you a video. It's about 60 seconds long. My colleague Steve deployed a camera set to video. Most of our cameras are set to photos. I asked him to set it in a place where you can see and hear the highway and hopefully see some wildlife. So I want to ask you to keep track of how many bears you see, and let's roll the tape. See the truck just pass by. Hello. There's one more. Come on. That's that. So thank you. I'm sorry we had some technical difficulties there. I hope you were able to grasp the message that I was trying to send. In terms of things that you all can do, well, first of all, you can support conservation. You can support Discover Life in America. Super important to have data. We can't protect things that we don't know exist, right? You could support National Parks Conservation Association or make a donation to the Safe Passage Fund. You know, inform yourself, reach out to your congressional representatives, let them know you support reducing wildlife vehicle collisions for both wildlife and for humans. Together, we can and will make a difference. Thank you so much. And at this point, I'm going to throw it back to Will so we can go to questions.
All right. Thanks so much, Jeff. And sorry, there's a thunderstorm going behind us, but I'll mute myself in just a second. So you guys can unmute yourself to ask a question, or you can also pop it in the chat and I will am happy to read it out. So ask some questions.
Any questions at all? There are no stupid questions, right? This is a very complex issue. There's a lot to it. And anything you want me to unpack, ask away. I'll try my best.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I had a question. Earlier, there was like a slide and you were saying that like one of the bears like went over to cross the road instead of using, I think it was a culver or something like that.
Right.
What might the... Like you were saying fencing, but like what might be the solutions to a problem like that where they don't want to go use a structure? Is there anything we can do about things like that?
So it is fencing. You know, so basically what it does is it forces them to cross at these openings. In this case, a concrete box culvert. So that's key. And if you can pair fencing effectively with structures, you can reduce wildlife vehicle collisions by up to 90%. Certainly not 90% on every project. You will see some failures, right? I was talking to someone out west, they built the new overpass, they opened it, and shortly thereafter there was a mountain lion dead in the road next to it, right? Animals are gonna move where they wanna move. You can do your best to keep them off the highway, but it's still gonna happen once in a while. So it really is all about fencing. And of course, putting that stuff in the right location.
Let's see, we have a question from Sylvia. What caused the changes in support for this project in the Tennessee and North Carolina governments?
Sure. Well, I think a couple things. Number one, we took a measured approach and a data-driven approach, and and worked on this over a number of years. And my role is a facilitator, right? I do some communications and advocacy as well, but I lead the meetings that we have. We come together in good faith. And over that period of time, we've built a community of practice, right? We're learning from one another. We've built relationships with one another. And this is the kind of project that people want to be a part of, right? In my line of work, often we're working to stop a threat, stop a development, stop the destruction of something. This is very proactive, right? We're trying to address a problem, but we're doing it proactively. And the way we've gone about it has been very attractive to the general public and politicians alike. Not that everybody, right? There's some people who are fiscally conservative who say, well, should we really be spending these resources, you know, with competing priorities? But I rarely find anybody who says this is not a wise investment of time and money. People really, really like this stuff. It's an idea whose time has come, quite frankly. And the federal funding didn't hurt, right? All of a sudden, when there's $350 million, people are like, yeah, okay, now we've got resources. We can do this.
Definitely. Donna asks about the Recovering America's Wildlife bill. If it passes the Senate, will additional funds be available for wildlife crossing structures? Do you know anything about that?
So I'm not down in the weeds on the bill we call RAWA. Basically, that bill, which has bipartisan support, will fully fund the state wildlife agencies to deal with their wildlife action plans. You have to have a wildlife action plan in the state. So a lot of it has to do with threatened and endangered species. I don't think there's money allocated for wildlife vehicle crossings, but it could help ramp up capacity for the state wildlife agencies. And that's always a beneficial thing, right? So there's my answer. It's kind of a non-answer because I believe the answer is no, but I'm not 100% sure, but NPCA does support that particular bill.
Cool. Heather asks, what kind of substrate or flooring is most likely to be best as opposed to the slippery metal culvert? Is like gravel or soil best, or is it best just to leave it open, or is there a better alternative?
Sure, that's a great question. Again, it's a question I can't answer, but I didn't delve into our consultants, and I think that this is the time to do it, right? So road ecology is a fairly new discipline. Most of the sort of work we're talking about has taken place out west. I showed you some photos from Banff National Park. Terry McGuire is a highway engineer who worked for Parks Canada. He built a lot of those structures in Banff, the underpasses and overpasses. We retained him as a contractor to work with the agencies, right? You know, side by side to help bring them along about what you can do. And that's been enormously helpful. A couple other road ecologists who we're working with, Marcel Hauser and Tony Clevenger, who work for the Western Transportation Institute. It's based at Montana State University. They're experts, right? So for these kinds of questions, we often look to the people who've done this over and over again in different parts of the world. Often the answers are dependent upon which species you're trying to move, right? It comes down to that. So.
Let's see. Mary asks about what kind of support or non-support you've gotten from adjoining counties in Tennessee and also the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service.
So Fish and Wildlife Service. Fish and Wildlife hasn't been that involved. They attended a wildlife crossing workshop that the U.S. Department of Transportation put on in Maggie Valley in 2018. We had 65 people over 2 days learning, right, in a community. Someone from the Colorado DOT came out. Tony Clevenger was there. Marcel Hauser was there. Tony wasn't there. Terry McGuire, highway engineer. But one thing that's really important to have someone like Terry, right, you have highway engineers and wildlife biologists. Biologists deal in probability. Engineers deal in certainty. How do these two people even communicate, right? Similarly, when you have more than 20 organizations coming together with 20 different missions, 20 different sets of priorities, 20 different sets of decision-making processes, you know, to come together and learn how to communicate, right? And those interpersonal relationships, the friendships that have been built over 5 years, really have us sort of poised for the next step. So I don't know if I deviated so far from that question that I didn't answer it.
What about the, sorry, it was Forest Service. Has the U.S. Forest Service been involved at all or been at least supportive?
Absolutely, which is really encouraging, right? The road actually goes more through the Forest Service. It doesn't go through the park, right? It's outside the park boundary. So the Forest Service is super important. We're working with their biologists and all the way up at the forest supervisor level. In North Carolina, certainly, we have support.
Another question, Susan, what road areas are some of the highest priorities in the future? I think you mentioned a couple of those. Are there any outside of I-40 that you know of that are, or at least outside of that small corridor that you know of that are high priority?
Sure, I-26, where we started research, I mentioned that. So that's Pisgah National Forest, Cherokee National Forest. Got a place like Rocky Fork State Park on one side and Big Bald where the Appalachian Trail crosses on the other, right? We need to reconnect these landscapes. You know, wildlife didn't evolve with cars, right? Needless to say, they've been moving across this landscape for millennia, and we built something that's a hard, hard obstacle. US 64 in the eastern part of North Carolina is an area with red wolves. There are some underpasses there, but there's a priority area. North Carolina DOT has announced they're going to build a wildlife overpass across North Carolina 143, just south of Fontana Dam in the Smokies. This is where the Appalachian Trail crosses at a place called Stokoe Gap. This is going to be the first overpass in the state. And in fact, I got a really nice note from the Wanda Austin, who is the division engineer for NCDOT Division 14, you know, thanking me for bringing everyone together because they learned so much about this issue through this collaborative that they decided to do this project on Stokoe Gap. So again, you know, that's the kind of email that just, you know, I was walking on air for a couple of days realizing that, yes, this is working. We're coming together and we're making a difference for wildlife and people. So Wildlands Network is going to release a report in a couple months with like the 20 hottest spots in North Carolina. I don't believe we're anywhere close to that in Tennessee yet, but so much more to come.
Fantastic. Well, any other questions? All right. Well, thanks so much, Jeff. We appreciate it. And just to remind everyone, we'll have this recording of this up on our YouTube channel, Discover Life in America, later next week. Well, thank you.
And thank you,
everyone, for joining in.
Have a great day.